Let's move on to talking about inflation. Let's get through some definitions before we do anything else. So, the price level is just the average level of prices in the economy. It's a pretty basic definition. Now, inflation is defined as the sustained increase in the general price level. And I want to emphasize the fact that it's a sustained increase. A simple one-time increase in the price level and then having it level off is not inflation. That's just a one-time increase. To be called inflation, it has to be sustained over a period of time. When we refer to deflation, the same applies. It's a sustained decrease in the general price level, so prices have to continually keep decreasing for it to actually be called deflation. Now, why are inflation and deflation actually problems? Well, if the inflation or deflation rate is low and steady, and it's anticipated, then they're not really a problem. But it's unexpected inflation and deflation rates, unexpected bursts of changes, that are actually problematic. And one of the main problems that arises is the redistribution of income. Employment contracts that firms make with their employees, they're active for more than a year. Sudden increases in the general price level, they don't bring increases to the nominal wage rate, so workers are actually worse off. Their wages buy less goods and services, and employers are actually better off because now their money is worth more, so they're better off. But sudden decreases in the price, again, they don't affect the nominal wage rate, but workers are better off because their real wage rate increases, which means the amount of goods and services that they can buy with the money that they take home is actually more than it was before. But employers are worse off because their profits decrease because they have to pay their workers more. We also have a diversion of resources from production. Resources are diverted towards forecasting inflation because this can become more profitable than actually inventing new products by managing investments. So this just overall lowers productivity in the economy. We also have a redistribution of wealth. People that enter loan contracts that are fixed in money terms and they pay an interest rate as agreed in a prior contract, they're affected. Sudden inflation can cause the money that the borrower repays to the lender to actually be worth less. So the borrower in this case would gain and the lender would lose. The interest rate is set on the expected inflation rate at the time of the signing of the contract. And if this changes, then the lender may lose money. Sudden deflation, on the other hand, causes the money that the borrower repays to the lender to be worth more than the original amount loaned. And in this case, the borrower loses and the lender wins. Let's take a look at the consumer price index. So the consumer price index measures the average price level, this average price level thing that I've been talking about this entire time. That all comes from the CPI. Now the CPI is basically just a basket of goods and services, and it gives the value of money compared to previous years. When we have a base reference year, the value of the CPI for that base reference year is equal to 100. If we have a CPI value, for example, in February 2016 of 127.1, and we have the CPI value in the base year, as I just mentioned, as 100, it doesn't matter what that base year is. The point here is that in February 2016, the average price level, the general price level, is 27.1% greater than it was in the base year, and that's what the CPI tells us. Let's look at how we actually construct a CPI. So we have a base year and a current year, and we have, let's say, two goods in each of these economies. It's limited to only two goods. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to find the cost of the CPI in base year prices. So we're going to take the base year, we're going to take the prices, we're going to multiply them by the quantities. So we have $5 per calculator multiplied by 5 calculators bought, and then we have $7 per book multiplied by 3 books bought. And so, in the base year, our value of the basket is $46. We're going to do the same thing, but I'm going to put a really, really huge emphasis on this. When we do this for the current year, the quantity of goods and services does not change in the basket. It may change in terms of how much was actually bought and sold in the current year, but the calculation that you use for CPI is going to be using the same quantities as the base year. That does not change. The only thing that changes here is the price. So now we're going to take $6 per calculator and again multiply it by 5 calculators bought. And we're going to take $10 that were per book in the current year, and we're going to be multiplying that by 3 books bought. despite the fact that in the current year we have 9 calculators sold and 12 books sold, we're going to ignore that for now. And so once we do that, we figure out that the value of the basket in base year prices for the, sorry, base year quantities in current year prices is $60. The next thing that we're going to do is we're just going to look at this equation here, because CPI is equal to the current basket over the base year basket. So we're going to take 60, divide that by 46, so current over base. We're going to multiply that by 100, and we're going to get a CPI value of 130.4. So basically, compared to a base reference year, this indicates to us that, in fact, the CPI, or the general price level, my mistake, is actually 30.4% higher than it was in the base year. Now, how do you calculate the rate of inflation? Well, that's pretty simple. If we take the CPI, the equation is as follows. We have CPI in the second year minus the CPI in the first year divided by the CPI in the first year multiplied by 100. Let's look at this example. So we have CPI 1 equal to 130.2, and we have CPI 2 equal to 143.5. What is the rate of inflation? We just plug the numbers in, 143.5, which is CPI in the second year, minus 130.2, which is CPI in the first year, divide that by the CPI in the first year, which is 130.2, multiply that by 100, and you get your CPI value, sorry, rate of inflation value of 10.2%. Let's differentiate between high rate of inflation and a high price level. First question you need to ask yourself, if you think, is this high level of inflation? Then you need to ask yourself, is the price level rising rapidly? If it is, then yes, it is inflation. But if it's not rising rapidly, then it's not really high level of inflation. You might have a really high price level, but it may not be increasing by much. So that's not a high level of inflation, that's just a high price level. If the price level is rising slowly, then it's a low rate of inflation. And remember, inflation is the sustained increase in general price level. So you may see one huge leap at some point and then it may level off. But that's not really inflation. That's just a one-time jump in the price level. There are a couple of disadvantages of using the CPI for calculating inflation. And they go as follows. We have the new goods bias. If the price level is compared between two distinct years, let's say back in the day when we had typewriters, that's the only good that we can really compare to use to compare to today's computers. The PC is much more expensive than the typewriter just because it's a new good. It's so much better than a typewriter. It does so much more stuff. So of course it's going to be more expensive. But according to the CPI, it's just inflation that's caused this. It doesn't actually see the difference in the fact that they're actually two completely different goods. We also have something known as the quality change bias. And part of the rise in prices is actually attributed to the improved quality rather than inflation. But CPI counts the entire price rise as inflation, and so it overestimates the rate of inflation. We can see here we have two phones. One of them is an old phone, the one on the top right. And the one on the bottom is a really new phone. Now, the quality in the new phone is way better than the quality in the old phone. So, of course, it's going to be more expensive. But according to the CPI, the change in price is simply due to inflation, which is not correct. We also have the commodity substitution bias. And this just means that changes in relative prices, they lead consumers to change the items that they buy. And the substitute good might provide them with the same value, but it might cost less. And this is shown in the decrease in the value of the basket of goods. So let's say you substitute Spam for steak. Well, the Spam's going to be a lot cheaper, and let's just assume that it gives you the same value. You're going to be buying more of that Spam and less of the steak. And so because Spam is cheaper, the entire CPI value goes down. And so it underestimates that rate of inflation. Lastly, we have outlet substitution bias. And this is just when customers face higher prices, they use discount stores more frequently and convenience stores. This is outlet substitution. And CPI surveys don't monitor this. For those of you who are unfamiliar, Loblaws is a very prominent and a little bit more high-end grocery store. And Bulk Barn is it's a bulk store. You buy stuff in bulk. So it's a lot cheaper than Loblaws is. And so people substitute bulk barn for Loblaws, and that's not accounted for in the CPI calculations. We have a couple of alternative price indices as well, and one of them is known as the GDP deflator. And the deflator is just equal to the nominal GDP over the real GDP multiplied by 100. And this real GDP, that value that we have, is calculated using the chained dollar method, which means that the actual weights attached to each item in the deflator are components of GDP in the current and preceding years. So what I'm trying to get at is that it incorporates the substitution bias and the new goods bias, as mentioned before. But the problem with this is that it's too broad of a measure of the actual cost of living, what the CPI is trying to give to us, and it includes a ton of items that consumers don't actually buy. The next alternative price index that we have is called the chained price index for consumption, or CPIC for short. And that's calculated as the nominal consumption expenditure divided by the real consumption expenditure multiplied by 100. Basically, the CPIC is an index of all the prices of all the items included in consumption expenditure only in GDP, as it's the ratio of nominal consumption to real consumption. And because it uses current and previous period quantities, because of the way it's calculated, it incorporates the substitution bias and the new goods bias and overcomes these problems faced by the original CPI. We also have something known as the core rate of inflation. And the core rate of inflation is simply the inflation rate that excludes volatile elements. And in core CPI, if you use the CPI to calculate it, this just excludes food and fuel because these are extremely volatile elements. The prices change all the time. But now the problem is that while it does remove these volatile elements from inflation, it gives a really misleading view of the true inflation rate because food and fuel are two very, very crucial parts of every household's expenditure. And if you just get rid of them, then you're not really seeing how much households are increasing this expenditure due to a rise in prices because of the amount of money that they actually spend on food and fuel. So that was a lecture on unemployment and inflation.